I'm so happy to welcome you to our first annual Sexual Assault Awareness Month conference. This is the first time we've ever done this, and it's so wonderful to see you all here. Let's give a round of applause for that. I want to start this event off by acknowledging that the room that we are in rests on the traditional lands of the Multnomah, Kathlamet, Clackamas, bands of Chinook, Tualatin, Kalapuya, Mualala, and many other tribes who made their homes along the Columbia River. Land acknowledgments like these are the first step in contributing to the awareness of the indigenous history of our city and the recognition of the resilience of the vibrant Native community that still calls this area home. As I said, I'm Elise Sanchez, and this week, 4 days ago, I began my role managing the Multnomah County Domestic and Sexual Violence Coordination Office. I've worked in the human services field here in Portland for just over 10 years, serving as the Child and Family Service Manager at NAIA Family Center under the direction of our keynote speaker, Tana Sanchez, and most recently as the Executive Director of the Oregon Community Health Workers Association. This is my fourth day on the job here at the DSVCO, and I'm really honored to spend it with all of you. The issue of sexual assault is one that is important to me both personally and professionally. As an Indigenous woman raising Indigenous children and with a long history working in culturally specific programs in my community, the statistics are really sobering. Native American women are 2.5 times more likely to experience sexual assault crimes compared to other races, and 1 in 3 Native women are raped or sexually assaulted in her lifetime. And we know that it's actually severely underreported due to the trauma of systemic and institutional oppression that our community experiences. Events like these are a huge step in raising awareness and building important skills and connection in our advocate community and beyond. For those of you working in social services 3 years ago, you may remember that this office was called the Domestic Violence Coordination Office, or DVCO. In 2016, with the support of the Multnomah County Board of Commissioners, the Department of County Human Services, and the newly created Sexual Assault Advisory Committee, we added the S and became the Domestic and Sexual Violence Coordination Office. We then set to work addressing the gap in funding in our community-based sexual assault providers, and we're now supporting the critical sexual violence response provided by Call to Safety, Proyecto Unica, and the YWCA of Greater Portland. We want to continue to enhance our support for these much-needed services to sexual violence survivors. The need for this service is great. Registration for this conference filled up within just a few days, and we believe that shows both the commitment to this work and the necessity for these conversations about sexual violence and how it impacts our community, especially for communities of color and for survivors who experience multiple intersections of oppression and deep disparities in their access to support and services. Throughout the day, we're going to be having some difficult and possibly triggering conversations, and I want to encourage all of you to take care of yourselves and each other. If you need someone to talk to at any point over the course of the day, please find someone wearing a name tag that says, "I'm here to support you." If any of those folks are in the room, will you raise your hand or stand if you're able? Oh, they might all be outside. They'll be supporting you out in the hallway. These folks are here to provide support if you need it. We've also designated a quiet space in room 209 for folks who may need some time to rest or take space. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask. A couple of other logistical items. Take a moment to note that there are emergency exits all around you. Find them, know them, love them. And yeah, please ask at the registration table if you need help locating them. Lunch and workshops will be across the street from here in the student, and lunch in the student union and workshops in Cascade Hall. Before we kick everything off, I'd really like to take a moment to thank the Sexual Assault Advisory Committee members who have planned this conference. If you're here, if you're not still planning and executing, will you stand for a moment and get recognized? Then you're going to have to clap really loud because they're all out in the hallway. This would not have been possible without their hard work and commitment, many of them volunteering and working outside of their scopes of work every day to really bring this together for all of us to come together around this issue. We also want to thank PCC for donating the space, which is a huge part of why we're able to do this. So thank you, PCC. And finally, to all of you out there in our community who are supporting our survivors every day, your work is so vital and we really appreciate you. So now, I'd like to introduce Commissioner my whole time in the car, Sushila. And I didn't do it. And now I'd like to introduce Commissioner Sushila Jayapal Commissioner Jayapal was elected to Multnomah County Board of Commissioners in 2019 and represents District 2, serving North and Northeast Multnomah County, and has been a resident of the district for 25 years. Commissioner Jayapal is a champion for survivors of domestic and sexual violence and sex trafficking. She chairs the local Sex Trafficking Collaborative Committee and the Domestic Violence Fatality Review Committee and the Gateway Center Advisory Council. We're really pleased to have her here with us supporting all the work you do. Let's have a hand for Commissioner Jayapal.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. It is so good to be here. Welcome to all of you. A huge welcome to Elise. We at Multnomah County are so happy to have you here with us, Elise. Thank you so much. So Elise mentioned the assignments that I have on the Domestic Violence Fatality Review, the Gateway Domestic Violence Council, and the Sex Trafficking Collaborative. I asked for those assignments, and I asked for them because of the particular impact that the issues of domestic and sexual violence and sex trafficking have on women, and in particular on women of color, immigrant and refugee women, women with disabilities, and our LGBTQ communities. While sexual and domestic violence knows no boundaries in terms of race, sexuality, or income, we know, and Elise gave some data, we know that these groups experience disproportionate rates of violence and experience significant barriers to service. As you, I'm sure, know, in Multnomah County, approximately 2,800 women are raped annually, and 14,000 experience other types of sexual assaults. To add to that, 75% of sexual assaults in Multnomah County are not reported. Specifically, people of color and other marginalized communities are less likely to report the assault to law enforcement and less likely to show up in hospital emergency rooms and thus less likely to receive services. For these reasons, in 2016, with feedback from local service providers like you, from the Domestic and Sexual Violence Coordination Office and the Sexual Assault Advisory Committee, the Multnomah County Board of Commissioners determined that there was a need to prioritize enhanced services for sexual assault survivors in marginalized and underserved communities. We at Multnomah County care deeply about sexual assault survivors and the trauma they experience. We recognize the need for a focus on services, crisis intervention, long-term help for the adverse effects of trauma, and prevention. As I was preparing these remarks, I learned that the movement to address sexual assault and violence against women was closely intertwined with the civil rights movement. I learned that Rosa Parks, who in popular culture is associated primarily with the Montgomery bus boycott and the civil rights movement, was also an activist and an organizer working to protest and make visible sexual and domestic violence against black women. Parks herself was assaulted by a white neighbor when she was 18. Well before the Montgomery bus boycott, Parks was organizing on behalf of black women survivors like Reese Taylor, a 24-year-old black woman who was gang-raped by six white men in 1944, and Gertrude Perkins, who was raped by two white police officers as she was walking home from a party in Montgomery, Alabama. Parks understood the intersectionality between racism and sexism long before the word intersectionality was in common use. We at Multnomah County understand that intersectionality as well, and that's why we are committed to addressing the root causes of violence, including structural racism and oppression. We are committed to a focus on prevention, and we are committed to serving the most marginalized through culturally specific services, including Latinx survivors through Proyecto Unica and LGBTQ survivors through Call to Safety. This is critical work being done to support survivors. It's not enough, there's much more to do, but it is where we begin. I found it difficult to read the stories of Reese Taylor, Gertrude Perkins, and the other women Rosa Parks advocated for. You hear these stories every day from the survivors themselves. I am grateful for your courage and your resilience, excuse me, in doing this work every day. On behalf of the Multnomah County Board of Commissioners, thank you so much for being here today And thank you so much for the service you provide our survivor community every single day. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Commissioner Jayapal for being here with us today. And now, it's my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Tana Sanchez. Tana Sanchez was honored in 2006 as a Buffett Award finalist for her steadfast commitment to help Native women and children lead lives free of violence and abuse. She has worked on peace and social justice issues on an international level. Sanchez is currently the Family Services Director at the Native American Youth and Family Center, coordinating services in domestic violence, rape prevention education, foster care services for youth and their families, early childhood programs, anti-poverty, and services to Native American elders. Sanchez has facilitated and led training workshops in culturally appropriate services, domestic violence and child welfare issues, drug and alcohol prevention, diversity, and internalized racism issues. In 2016, Tana Sanchez was elected to the Oregon House of Representatives representing House District 43, which is in North and Northeast Portland. And yes. And I just want to say personally, I'm so happy to have her here today. Tana Sanchez is a huge reason why I do this work and why I've been able to continue to do this work. And I think for many of us in the Native community, we can say the same thing about her. So it's fantastic that she's agreed to be with us here today. And so I'd love for you all to welcome Representative Tana Sanchez.
Goodness, I always feel so short around her too. Like I'm just not tall enough. So many of you may know the legislature is in session. So I've been a little bit busy recently. And when this event came up on my calendar, my apologies, my first thought was, oh shit. I hadn't, you know, necessarily taken all, I mean, you know, I think about this. I have to drive to Salem and back every single day. So a lot of things roll through your head because, you know, you can't read while you're driving or write while you're driving. So I was thinking like, okay, what am I going to do? What am I going to talk about? What am I going to talk about? And I was talking to my son recently about giving this speech this morning. And he said, well, whatever you do, Mom, don't talk too long. Because no matter what they say, people really do not want to sit and listen to somebody talk for an hour. And I thought, God, you're so smart. You're such a smart kid. He's 36 years old, so he, you know. But it is always amazing as a parent to hear these little pearls of wisdom coming from somebody who used to rant, I'm not tired, before they fell asleep in their food. But, you know, he really is very, very smart. And so I thought about him in a lot of ways when I was kind of coming up with some things that I wanted to say to you today. And I was remembering that when he was a teenager, about 20 years ago, I used to censor all the music and the media and the different things that he would hear. Because what I heard every single day in the media was, you know, things that were disparaging, things that were disrespectful and just very painful, I thought, in the media. And I told him he could play whatever he wanted until I heard something not okay, until I heard, you know, some vulgar language or some, you know, some really horrible thing that, you know, somebody was promoting violence or degrading women. And after a while, he'd get a little frustrated with me and he'd say, Mom, not everything is about degrading women. And at that point in time, I said, yes, it is. Yes, it is. Because in the media, there is a lot. It's huge. And I thought about that a lot, you know, thinking about where we are today with media and all of those different things and how that is promoting some of the things that we're dealing with. So yeah, so I started from that place in my mind. So, and then the next thought that ran through my head was, what do you want to know about? So who here has maybe never been to a conference like this? Everybody. Oh, maybe a couple people. So if you're a little newer to this, you may be really interested to hear all the statistics and what's going on with current laws and the national trends and, you know, all of that kind of things. You might be, you know, wondering all of those things, but I'll be perfectly honest. I have sat through many, many conferences, And I remember hearing the statistics and the different details and thinking, great, somebody's tracking that. I'll have to remember it. Because I don't. I usually don't remember it. But what I listen for is things like, what are the numbers telling us? Where are we as a state? Where are we in Oregon, you know, in terms of are we making precedent-setting laws, or are we last in line to come up with the answers and figure out what to do next? Where are we, you know, in making change and shift? As I said, I won't remember the statistics, but I think it's really, really important to hear some of those things. So hopefully you'll hear a lot today. I think Sushila talked a little bit about things. That's important stuff, but I'm not going to talk about that today because, as I said, I won't remember them anyway. Those of you who have been around for a little while, though, might be waiting to hear something about funding or different opportunities, and because we know how hard the work is to do without money. But we also know that we've been doing it forever with whatever we have, right? We've been making shift, we've been making change no matter what. So we also sit maybe and wait to hear whether or not, you know, some law has changed and turned back time and made things difficult again. They're always going to be difficult, maybe. But in thinking about this, the thought that really rolled through my head was, what if we weren't here? Not what if we weren't here to do this work, but what if we didn't have to be here? What if we didn't have to have conferences about sexual assault or domestic violence? What if we actually lived in a society where domestic violence and sexual assault were not the norm? What would that look like? So I want you to hold that thought for a little bit. We all know at the moment that this isn't the norm. This is where we are. Those of you who do this work every day, you hear the stories every day, and you wonder if it'll ever end, or if we, you know, how we can figure out a way to stop it, or so we legislate, we educate, you know, we safety plan, we even design rape-proof underwear. Have you seen that? It's out there. Our society has come to a place where we plan for trauma. We build our homes and our businesses. Elise mentioned all of the exits, so people will know. We design where the cameras will go. We try to make sure that there are no blind corners, that there are clearly marked exits, as she said, that no one's back is to the door if that makes them nervous. That would be me. I don't sit with my back to the door ever. And then there are almost cameras everywhere, right? We all have a camera in our purse, pocket, right? And we plan for safety all the time. We plan for safety for our children from infancy to college and beyond. We plan for these things every single day. As advocates, we work for years to assist in the development of laws to respond to what are historical situations. Long, long time ago, we tried to change laws from the past, or the lack of laws that allowed sexual assault. And back in the day, it was essentially a property crime, right? Sexual assault was a property crime. Right? Sexual assault was the thing that you blamed the victim for over and over again. Or was it a hidden crime that we just didn't talk about? Nobody mentioned it. If it happened, we tried to stay quiet about it, and people just held their hearts. We know that historically violence against women is a method that was used to fracture societal norms, to essentially break the spirits of victims. Patriarchy knew this, and they used it to the best of its ability. So I'm sure you've heard of an old Cheyenne proverb that reads, a nation is not conquered until the hearts of its women are on the ground. That's a sobering thought. It goes on to say, then it is done, no matter how strong their warriors, no matter how powerful their weaponry. The question now is, the methodology that is being used at the moment to attempt to break the people's spirits or smash their hearts to the ground, what are we doing about that? What can be done? I asked that question, what would it be like here if we didn't have to be here? We didn't have to be advocates or trainers or sane nurses. what would the world look like? What would it look like if we woke up, if we could wake up every single day with no fear for our personal safety? For that of our children, our families, our community? And I get it that that's kind of a crazy question, because, you know, for the most part, most of us right now would never let our guard down, right? We would never for a moment think that we would be safe enough to walk the streets alone at night in the dark. And I thought about that. It really literally came through my mind. Okay, what have I been taught all my life? Stand with your right foot, or your left foot forward, your right foot back one step, and the shoulder width so that you can't get knocked over. Right? That's how we were taught. We were trained that way. And you ask yourself that question, how did that happen? How did we get to that place? Well, we got to that place because societies have changed and shifted over generations. We got to that place because, believe it or not, there were societies, matriarchal and even patriarchal societies, that did not believe in interpersonal or familial violence. But what happened? What changed? What shifted? What shifted is situations happen where somebody wanted more than they had, and so they decided to take it. And in taking that, they had to damage somebody. So we all know that's the whole power and control dynamic, right? So you damage somebody else to get what you want. I thought about that a lot, like what is that concept all about? Well, you know, greed in general. And I thought to tell you about a situation, or maybe it's a language structure thing. I wanted to identify it because I think it's really, really important, because we think about language every day, right? And I wanted to make, let me preface this by saying my intention in this comment is not about not about gender. It's not about race or ethnicity. My intention is to identify a historical fact in what I'm about to tell you. So, in the Lakota language, there is a word that's often used to describe white people. And the word is wasichu. I want you to hear that word, wasichu. But the word for white is actually ska. And the word for man is wichasha, which is very different than wasichu. So you know that white man is not the literal translation of that word, right? So I asked that question, as I'm not a Lakota speaker. What does that word actually mean? That word actually means taker of the fat, taker of the best, and leaving the rest for everybody else. And I say that to you because I want you to understand, from a language standpoint, this is, Lakota were a people, of course, you know, only a few generations back who had encountered Europeans coming forward and encountered that concept. I mean, they knew the concept, obviously, because they had a word for it, but they encountered the concept of somebody who was more prone to take for themselves rather than care about the rest of the people. And that's an important thing, because that's what we're experiencing over and over and over again right now. We all know that, those of us who work in other social services, you know that we are in a place where the richest of the rich are only like 1 or 2% in the entire country, right? And the poorest of, you know, the poor are the majority at this point. So we're living a strange time. But that time has ebbed and flowed over generations, as I said. It's gotten better, it's gotten worse, and those societies that didn't tolerate that interpersonal or familial violence have ebbed and flowed as well. So what changed? What shifted? Well, if you are a historian, you can watch it change and shift over many generations, right? And as I said, I was having that conversation with my son about coming to talk to you, and he told me something that, you know, because we were just going back and forth about it, like, you know, what's the thing about sexual violence? What's the thing about, you know, all of the stuff that's going on today? And he says to me, he said, you know what, Mom? We know that no society is perfect, and that ebbing and flowing of societal norms that okays or doesn't okay this type of behavior changes over time. So it's about people being born and people dying and how we maintain societal norms. He said it's like a six-pack, not a six-pack of beer. It's like a physical body six-pack, right? Your physical health, wellness, all of that. You have to maintain it. You can't just get a six-pack, work hard for a six-pack, and then think it's going to stay there for the rest of your life, right? It's not going to. You have to maintain it. And so what happened at some point in time is that we did not maintain the physical health of our society. And we have allowed to a degree, not we personally, because we're the fighters, right? But the society in and of itself has opted for money or greed to take it over. Rather than accepting a societal norm that says, maybe we don't put out the movie that, you know, disrespects, you know, women, or the video or the music or the magazine or whatever that okays this behavior or that changes the dynamic about how a young girl should feel about herself physically or, you know, emotionally or whatever. Maybe we don't do that. And maybe we don't make as much money. But that's the hard part. That's the hard part that we have to get to. So what is it going to take to get us to that place where we don't have to be here? That's a shift in societal norms. And that's our job, right? So it isn't about being angry or being frustrated or being hurt by what we, you know, emotionally what we have to do every day. And although that's real, that is real, it's what happens. I've been doing this work for many, many years. But I appreciate that my son can tell me it's important for us to be able to learn to maintain this. When we change and shift this dynamic in the future, because it clearly is changing, right? We clearly have a voice that's loud and clear right now. It really will be about how strong we are, how hard we work to make it happen, and how well we can teach the next generation and those seven generations after that to maintain the wellness that we want to create. So, again, I'm not going to talk long. I'm done. I just wanted to tell you that today, that I think it's really, really important that you're here. I think the work that you do every single day is so vital to our future. And I want to thank you for being here and taking your time and energy to move forward from where we are now to where we need to be. Thanks.